right, guys, it is 5:32. Nate, that's me. I'm on the line with you. We're going to be doing a little coaching call today, and I've got a very special guest, one of my favorite guests, Elizabeth Infant. She's going to be online as well. And
hi, guys.
Yeah, there we go. We're going to go give a little shout out there. And guys, we're going to really dig into some great stuff today. We've done a few different calls, and of course, you can go down all these different rabbit holes when it comes to food and fueling and nutrition. Today, the particular rabbit hole we're going to dive down into is going to be race day fueling in honor of the Boston Marathon next week, which I am running. I'm very excited about it, and I'm going to be very selfishly using Elizabeth's knowledge to help me out and make sure I'm set up for success. So that's going to be the first part of today's chat. Then what we're going to do is take some of your guys' live calls and questions that we've gotten. Elizabeth has gotten some on email and through the Facebook group. We want to help you guys out. And then also in the background, Elizabeth and I have been working hard away at a very cool new program that we want to show you guys that we really think is going to help you guys out based on the last couple calls we've had and the type of things you guys are going on. So we got a lot going on. We're going to talk about marathon fueling. We're going to get into some questions, and we're going to show you guys a little sneak peek of this new program we got up our sleeve. Elizabeth, are you ready?
I'm ready. Let's dive right in.
Let's dive right in. Fantastic. So we've got our questions here. That's Sam, Elizabeth in the house. That's right. So Elizabeth, we were chatting a little bit before we got going here, and you were starting to ask me some questions about the Boston Marathon, and I thought maybe you could just start with, how do you approach race day fueling, like with your clients? Like, what are the things that you generally like to see and the things you generally like to ask?
Sure. So when we start to talk about race day fueling, there are a couple main points that I want people to pay attention to. And this is long before that race day actually comes. As I know, any runner that's, spent any time in running circles, you've heard them say practice, practice, practice. Whatever you're going to be doing on race day, don't start that on race day. So I like to have a couple, long sessions, a couple weeks or months ideally ahead of time to start looking at how much you're going to be drinking. So hydration needs, what kinds of products are going to be available on the course, what kinds of products are going to work best for each individual. So for you as a runner, I know Nate and I, we both have very different digestive systems. One of us can eat anything, and the other of us, myself, can eat practically nothing, which I don't know if that's the universe's way to get me to focus on my run form. Since yours is perfect, Nate, I think that the universe is just letting you eat, whereas mine, it's like, no, don't worry about food. Do not injure yourself running.
Mine is perfect for 3-second video clips.
Hey, perfect. I would be happy with 3 seconds. So anyway, so looking at you as an individual runner and then really diving into the course, so the race itself, and taking a glance at what is it, a hilly race? Is it a race at altitude? Is it a race that's going to be, that is downhill and then there's a slight climb at the end, or vice versa? Are you going to be racing downhill? Is your pace going to increase that last mile? Are you racing in a cold temperature or a really humid temperature? So there are all these different variables that you want to play with. So I like to make a list. I'm a big list person, and so kind of so you can start checking off these boxes. And I know that you and I talked a little bit before of, what boxes you have to check off and what you've been doing, and you've done a great job kind of practicing on some of your long runs. We've made some tweaks and adjustments along the way for several things.
Yeah, and like, who knew your advice actually works and does magical things? Who knew?
20% of the time.
20% of the time. That's really cool. I like that. So it sounds like, it's the week before race. Boston Marathon is Monday, and it's very natural to have those doubts of like, oh my goodness, I haven't done enough training, or oh my goodness, you know, that one workout didn't go that well, or I feel like I've got a cough coming on, you know, you really want to go back and think about all the workouts you've done and the consistent training you've done and realize that you're a real product of that. And it sounds like it's the same for nutrition. It's not any last minute
Absolutely.
Crazy changes with your food and your fueling, but you're really a product of everything you've done up to this point.
Very true. And if there's kind of one thing that I can make, try to reassure people or bring to their attention, it's that aside from illegal performance-enhancing drugs, a week out from your race, the day of your race, the morning of your race, no matter what you see at Race Expo, no matter what one of your friends tells you, there's nothing you can take or do that is going to change your performance so substantially that it's worth risking the race.
Totally.
So don't freak out. Don't change. You've put the time in training. You've tried different things. You know what works for you. Stick with it and go into the race confident that you've set yourself up for success.
That's awesome. I like that. I definitely like that. It's nice to hear at this time as well. And we were chatting a little earlier. I was like, oh man, I hope she like totally thinks that my plan isn't terrible because I don't know what else I'm going to do. It's too close to the darn race. So let's kind of go through this, you know, and I know a lot of guys are doing some of these major races. And, you know, what's interesting about major races is that you can't just roll out of the car and go right to the starting line. You know, when you're at a race that has 15, 20, 25,000 people, there's going to be, you know, a lot of transport and transition time early on. So, you know, what do you recommend for that, you know, going in? Because obviously I think the Boston Marathon's an 8 a.m. start. And, you know, to get to the bus and to get the bus taken out to the start of the race, you know, I'm going to have to be a lot earlier. I'm thinking it's going to be probably a 4 or 5 a.m. wake up call. You know, what do you think I should be working on for, you know, in terms of when I eat breakfast, you know, maybe if I should be snacking or sipping on something before the start of the race, and when should I stop doing all that stuff?
Okay, that's a good place to start. I think I'd like to even look at the night before, because that's, to me as a nutritionist, where you're going to be kind of putting money in the bank, so to speak, and setting yourself up for a good next morning. So in kind of the nutrition world, we have what's called the postprandial glycemic response, PPGR. Basically, it's if you go kind of lower carbohydrate on a meal, your let's say your dinner in this case, your following meal, so the breakfast the next morning, you'll have a better absorption of that glucose, so of those carbohydrates. So the night before, as you're getting set up for your race and you're going out to your pre-race dinner, that old school carbo loading mentality isn't the best place to be. That's not the best place to be loading up on carbohydrates.
Interesting.
So you want to have a good, either a fish or a chicken or some easily digestible source of protein, lentils, quinoa if you're a plant-based athlete, and then you want to have a good amount of fat. So, you know, either healthy oils, avocados, nuts, and really go lower on the carbohydrates. So you might get, you know, some from like squash, those kinds of things. And then make sure, you know, you're in bed early, you let sleep and digestion take place, so that then that next morning when you do have that 5 a.m. wake up call, your body is primed and ready to absorb those carbohydrates, the glucose, and then be able to use that as fuel.
So
there's the insider tip.
That's a really interesting insider tip, Elizabeth. That's definitely not something you hear every day. So basically, it's like the anti pre race pasta dinner. You're basically saying go the other way. And
I am. And
and just to review,
two nights before, go right ahead and have your pasta dinner.
Ah, so if you're going to do that more pasta-style dinner, it's better to do two nights before. But basically, can you review that again one more time? I feel like that's important. So basically, like, the night before, if you are consuming, you know, a larger amount of carbohydrate, that's going to affect your ability to absorb it the morning after? Is that what is that?
That's going to make you less, less sensitive to kind of the utilization and effects of those carbohydrates that next day.
Interesting. Huh. Okay. Well,
Yes.
that works well. I
Yes.
usually
So that's.
I've been someone who's always been like able to do like a chicken or steak and some veggies and some other things or potatoes on the side, but I've never done too crazy down the pasta dinner route the night before.
Good, good. So yeah, so that's kind of
Okay.
a good way, and it's easy. It's easier on digestion. It helps you go to sleep. So
That's
that way,
good.
that morning, you wake up, you're hungry, you're ready at 4 a.m. for your pre-race breakfast. And whether you, I think timing-wise, again, is an individual thing. I would like more time for my body to digest. You would like a little bit less. So in that four to, before you get on the bus
Yeah.
window is your pre-race breakfast, which we'll talk about yours specifically. But then in that transition on the way over there, depending on how long you're actually going to have before the gun goes off, if it's, longer than an hour and you're an athlete that needs that fuel, then, that's kind of the optimal time. It's if you've, and we're all friends here, so we can talk about this. If you've gone to the bathroom, you've
Yeah.
had everything good for the day and you're ready, which is important.
Yes, it is, for
So
sure.
no one likes to run on a full stomach.
No, definitely not.
And then it's a good time then to be hydrating and have, anywhere, again, this is totally individual, but anywhere from 50 to 100 calories of kind of a easily digestible fuel source. But it's also the bet a good window to be hydrating. So
Yeah.
that's your pre-race window.
I like that, the pre-race window. Yeah, so for me, my plan, not to bore you all with the details of my breakfast, but I'm usually a connoisseur of the morning egg sandwich. That's usually something that treats me pretty good. So some sort of, egg and bacon or egg and sausage, and some sort of bread, situation seems to always work pretty good for me. And I could do the cereal oatmeal route, but I do find I like a little bit of protein and fat in there, especially for a longer race morning. And I feel like for me, if I was going to be racing like a 5K or a mile, I'd be, less concerned about what I was eating and would eat either little or nothing. But with the marathon being such a relatively easier paced start, especially if you're doing it right, I don't find that it's that taxing on my stomach that way. So I feel like I want more of a meal before I go into the marathon. And especially because I know that there's going to be a huge gap between breakfast and the start of this thing. So for me,
Yeah,
that's sort of what I've
absolutely.
been
And
thinking about.
that's a great breakfast to start off with. And I think it's a good idea to tell people, I don't know if you're staying in a hotel that has a kitchen, but not everybody's going to have the availability to scramble up some eggs. So hard-boiled eggs work well too. And those you can buy at almost any grocery store now, and keep those in your little mini fridge or in a little cooler the night before. Some hotels, if they're race hotels, they'll open up the bar downstairs and they might have scrambled eggs. So
They'll have a
just
little
don't
breakfast
worry
or
if
something.
you're, there are ways to get around not having a kitchen,
Yeah, but they're gonna have, that
if you have
kind
a
of plan
microwave.
a little bit later. And then I was gonna
Yeah,
sip on
so.
some fluids on the bus, and I told you I've been training with some nut butters, and I might take a nut butter probably. Like, when should I take that nut butter between, like, how close to the start of the race itself?
So for you personally, I would say you've got 45 minutes or so before the start of the race. And that's
Okay.
because we've kind of talked about not that you're not going to need fuel then for basic almost the first hour. If I thought you were going to need some kind of fuel, like if the first maybe 10 miles were climbing, then it might be a little different. I might have you take that a little sooner or a little closer to the start of the race, but I know that we've looked at the course and it's, I think, somewhat downhill.
It is a part of a downhill
So
start.
yeah. Yeah, so I think so that'll be a little easier. You're not going to be relying so much on energy, and I call them the gun going off nerves will help kind of push you through and speed you up. So I think you're about 45 minutes out would be a good time for you personally to take that nut butter.
Yeah, okay. So yep. So I got that there. And then the other thing I was going to work on was basically, you know, things in the past that I've trained with have been shot blocks. Now, interestingly for me, when I've been doing my long runs, I've been training basically on nut butter alone. And the thing I changed to a little bit later was, you know, an electrolyte beverage. I do a bottle, and I saw that Sam was asking about, you know, holding a water bottle during a race. I'm actually going to plan on racing with a water bottle, Sam, in this, and we'll talk about why in a second. And then I was going to do shot blocks, and I was going to carry those with me, a couple packs. And I was trying to think about when I should start eating those. And Elizabeth, you were saying some interesting things earlier about, you know, sometimes about like you kind of reduce your sensitivity to them the earlier you start consuming them. Did I have that right?
Yes. Yep. And it's not specifically that your sensitivity goes down, but that your body starts relying on those sugars for that energy. You start getting, so it's, you know, if you're going to be utilizing sugar as that fuel source to kind of help get you through, then you ideally you wouldn't start consuming that sugar right away. You would save it for later in the race when the body needs it more.
Exactly. So,
as your body tires, as the pace, you know, as you want to, if you want your pace to increase, that kind of thing.
Interesting. And then for you, when you're setting up guidelines, like, do you think I should have a certain mile marker or time in mind? Or do you think I should just like feel this out when I think it's like time to start eating, you know, the sugar stuff? And then alternatively, could I miss that window? Could I be like starting to eat it too late? And then that becomes a problem in and of itself.
Sure. So for you personally, because you've trained almost fasted, because you're an experienced runner, and I feel like you know your body pretty well, I think going by feel is a good guideline for you personally. Mm-hmm. We set a time marker of 50 minutes for you.
Yeah.
So as our safeguard. So I want you, as your coach, I would say at the 50 minute mark, check yourself.
Okay.
How are you feeling? How have you been drinking? How's your body responding? Do you need to start fueling?
Yeah.
Whereas with maybe more beginner athletes, I would put them on a really balanced timing plan because A, they're nervous. B, they may or may not have done this before a dozen times. C, they'll forget, right? They'll be looking, worrying about other things. So the more experienced you are, I think the less that, you know, setting yourself a beeper reminder for every 7.5 minutes is necessary. And then that increases, that awareness increases as you get more experienced.
Yeah. So for me, you know, looking at this map here, you know, the first time that I'm going to like really touch any fuel is probably going to be in that 6 to 7, 6 to 8 mile window, based on what I think I'll be running for timing. What, let's say I'm brand new to this, Elizabeth, and this was one of my first marathons. What would that stricter guideline look like? How would you set that up? Because I know some of our runners are looking for those types of guidelines too.
Great. I think for beginner runners, it's a good idea to look at kind of a 15 to 25 minute, somewhere in that window. So if you want to say, you know, the average 20 minutes of fueling as a reminder for how often they want to fuel. Most athletes don't need within the first, you know, several miles. If you've had a good breakfast, if it hasn't, you know, if it's been maybe 2 or 3 hours since you ate that breakfast and it's starting to digest, you still have enough glucose on board, enough available energy to start that race off. So, you know, you definitely don't need to be mile one popping some kind of a, you know, a chew, one of those sport jelly beans, whatever, you know, your gel if you're crazy and that's what you want to use. So looking at, you know, at the 20-minute mark, the 40-minute mark, or if it's an easier marking, then use the aid stations. You know, if they're set up every mile, whether or not you fuel every mile, it's an easy reminder to do something every mile. So drinking, taking a sip from a water bottle or taking a cup of water from the aid station or fueling, grabbing one of those chews, you know, a pretzel, if you will, but whatever it is that your fueling choice is, yeah. Use the aid stations as markers.
Totally.
But newer athletes need a little bit better reminding time, and I think it also helps calm them down, that knowing that they have a schedule, that's one less thing that they have to worry about.
You know, the other thing I like about that approach, Elizabeth, is that it's another little strategy to keep the athlete in the moment. You know, all they have to focus on is the intervals in between when they, you know, when they feed, when they eat something. It's like, okay, all I have to do is focus on the next 20, 30 minutes, you know, till I get to that thing again, and I'll
exactly.
be good to go. I like that a lot.
Exactly.
Now, the other thing we talked about was hydration. And, you know, Sam is asking about a water bottle. He says he plans on running with the water bottle. I'm actually going to as well. He does ask, you know, holding a water bottle with drink mix is tiring, but when bottle's empty, what next? Well, depending on how much you like that water bottle, Sam, you may just want to go ahead and ditch the thing.
Yep.
You know, I might run with just kind of a crappy disposable water bottle, not one of my nicer handhelds, for this one, because I'm probably going to do the same thing. And I'm doing that for a few reasons. You know, this is going to be a bigger race. I'm starting in the charity wave, so I'm going to be a little bit further in the back, and I'm willing to bet that those initial aid stations are going to be pretty busy and saturated. And rather than, you know, stress myself out trying to hop around people to get, you know, the right food and fluid there, and then to, you know, worry about like dropping a cup or only getting like a quarter, you know, cup full of water, I would rather just happily chug away, you know, carrying, you know, the quote unquote extra weight. And that will probably get me through the first hour to, you know, hour and a half, depending on how hot things are. And then as things start to thin out, then I can start to go and rely on the aid stations themselves.
And I think that's a really solid plan that you have in place there. I like that. I always recommend that, you know, if they can, that my athletes carry their own, whether it's a handheld flask or an actual water bottle. I think just in the long run, you're winning. I like to try, you know, and be a good environmentalist and say, if you can either throw the bottle when you're done with it in the recycle, you know, if by the cups, like not just in the middle of the road, I write a little positive message on mine with a Sharpie. So for whoever finds it, I imagine that they then see that message and feel really good about themselves and want to like I'll put like pass the bottle on, or, you know, I mean, again, I'm sure it goes into the trash logically, but in my head, I feel like I'm at least trying.
I like that. That's like very message in a bottle, you know, float it out and see, right? And then see who gets it. That's really cool.
Maybe
you can put your address on there and be like, hey, if you find this, ship this back to me.
Yeah. But do not come crazy stalk me. No, I'm sorry. My mother would freak. Yeah. Although I don't know, maybe this is a new way to get dates. Anybody out there that's single, they want to put their digits maybe, or in this day and age, their like Instagram handle or something like that. Hook me.
Totally.
Hit me at.
Totally. So
carrying it is a good idea, and avoiding those early aid stations. If you don't want to carry your hydration, then, you know, you're leaving yourself the only option of relying on what's on course. Which, you know, if you've tried that out and it happens to work for you, that's fine. Go with it. It's race week. I don't want anyone to change anything race week. And I'm not saying that that's going to hamper your race in any way. If it works for you, go with it. You know, it is what it is. But for you personally, you've carried a bottle. You know how that feels in your hand, and you're willing to, you know, put kind of your hydration needs as priority number one.
Yeah. You know, I have a little strategy with my water bottle because I do feel like the water bottle affects my arm swing and my mechanics a little bit, which I'm always sensitive to and never really like. I think that's one of the reasons why the water bottle is a pain in the butt. So I will switch hands usually every 15 minutes. And I found an extra mile long runs. That was actually a nice little, you know, mental way to break down the run. It's like, okay, I only need to focus on the next 15 minutes. Then I get to switch hands. Then I get to, like, you know, reset things. So I kind of like that strategy just to switch up my arms so that I'm not just chronically stiff on one side as I run and go down the road.
Yeah. Which, and we could even take that further for people and say that when they're, you know, as they're switching, that's when they take their drink or that's when they eat, right? So that it's all these cues are kind of happening at once. And it can, that can be the time that they kind of like check their posture, check their run form, drink a little, eat a little, like it's on those little intervals that they're kind of doing that check-in with themselves to make sure that everything is on track.
Yeah, I really like that. Basically, anything that keeps you in the moment. I remember when I ran my first Boston years ago, I think I was like 40 minutes in, and I was thinking I was going to be running about 3.5 hours, and I was like, I have another 3 hours of running. It was just like this like monumental thing. I was just like, how am I going to do this? Like that was like my moment of depression in the race. I'm glad I got it out of the way earlier, but I was like, I have 3 hours of running. This is so much. How am I going to do this thing?
So how do you tell your runners to get through that? Because I'm sure people will feel this either at Boston. I mean, obviously they've been through it before if they're at Boston, but in some of their other upcoming races, how do you get through that?
You know, I really like, you know, staying present. I think at the time I was just running. I didn't really have a lot of ammo, mental ammo to keep me focused in the present other than, you know, there's this black abyss between where I was and the finish line. And, you know, now I think basically what's so sneaky and elegant about just this nutrition plan alone is that all I have to do is focus on the next 10, 15 minutes or 20 minutes or my next interval. And all I do is just mentally reset every 20 minutes. You know, having those little check-ins, I think, is so key. And the times you feel bad, it's just like, no, I'm just focusing on the next 20 minutes. You know, the other thing I will say also for my athletes who are in the triathlon world, it's like, you know, it's a lot of miles and it's too long for nothing to go wrong. You know what I mean? Like something is
going to happen.
Like it could be like someone trips and falls in front of you, an aid station doesn't work, you get a cramp, your shoe comes untied. And if something goes wrong, one, you always have a chance to recover because it's so long, right? You've got plenty of time to get back into things. And the other thing that I found is that if I kind of go in mentally expecting not everything to be perfect, when things don't go planned, I'm already mentally prepared to adapt. You know, and I find that kind of flexibility is great because for me and for a lot of athletes, you know, stress really comes from situations that we don't expect. They're unwarranted. We don't know what's going on. But, you know, if you can almost like, you know, you outthink the stress, you get there before the stress does, and you think about the potential situations that could happen, you're like, oh, well, yeah, this sucks. My shoe's untied or I'm dealing with this cramp. But you want to know what? I actually have a little strategy to approach it. And I think with a lot of athletes, especially when they deal with cramping, I found that I've been able to deal a lot of that with better breathing, with being a little bit more relaxed. And that can so easily go the other way when you just, your body freezes up because one area of you is cramping or something isn't going well. It's just, you know, that thinking goes out the window.
Yep, absolutely. That's great.
I like that. So,
I think one more thing.
Yeah, please.
Oh, go ahead.
No,
sorry.
You go in and jump in. I was just looking at some of the questions people are going, and I wanted to kind of open this up to some people, but you finish with that one more thing.
All right. So my one more thing I will regroup on these at the end, but as your pacing and your speed increases, your digestion rate decreases. So be cognizant of how fast, you know, we all go out on those early miles kind of fast, and notice, you know, how your body is responding, increased heart rate, increased effort, increased sweat rate, like all of these things. If you've been able to, you know, eat a Piggy bar or Bonk Breaker bar or whatever gel or goo that you have before in the past has been fine with no problem, that was training, this is racing. So be aware that you might want to, you know, dial it down a little, take smaller bites, take slower, you know, in your case, like let that, you know, chew on that chew for a minute, have a little water to wash it down, you know, and try to slow digestion down and know that as your pace increases, your digestion rate is going down. Also.
Yep, that's a great point, because in my long runs, I've been doing a good job of obeying the speed limits and staying slower. And, you know, for better or worse, I haven't raced yet this year. So I actually haven't tried out this specific race plan. I've used some similar ones in the past, so I know generally it works, but it's a really good point. You never know what's going to happen on race day. And when you're going a little bit harder, it's important to manage those things for sure. So I think that's really good. Elizabeth, should we open it up to some questions?
Yes, please. Let's get at these.
Let's get these. So Sam, I wanted to put you on the mic because you have been, you know, with us for a long time. I think you posted a question last time we didn't get to you, but you had a few different things. So Sam, I'm going to unmute you. And if you're in a good spot, we can get you going. And you can ask away anything you've got going on.
Hey, how you doing?
Good. Sam, we can hear you.
All right, cool. I'm in Orlando, Florida. Okay. I'm business from Michigan, and been following you guys for a long time. You too, Elizabeth.
Thank you.
I am running, truthfully, call me crazy, but I'm running a half marathon every weekend for the last 7 weeks. So I am doing it for different reasons. Building up my mitochondria, my endurance, my form, everything's working great. Just finished a half marathon in Kentucky last weekend, and nothing blowing out. I'm not doing any PRs. I'm just building for my goal of 3 hours and 45 minutes for Detroit Marathon in October. Lots of experimentation going on, and one of the areas I'm finding right now is hydration. How do I keep that going? That's what my question was. Carry a water bottle, but when I'm all done with my drink, do I keep another baggie of my mix in my pocket? How do I keep things going to keep that refresh feeling going? Because I don't like taking things from aid stations. I refuse it because I got sick one time.
Okay, great. First of all, congratulations on working so hard towards a goal. I really admire that. I think I can tell you're just, you're on track, and it's admirable. So keep going. I bet you'll get there, especially with Nate's help. The run community is awesome in here. As far as carrying your hydration with you, depending on what kind of hydration you use, some of them come in little tabs, which you can break half and chew on. Some of them are powders, and I will pour the powder directly into my mouth, and then take, you know, not all of it at once.
Hashtag hardcore.
I'm choking right now.
I know. It is, but I'm also the girl that like will chew the BCAA tablets so that it absorbs faster, and those things are the worst tasting pill. I mean, it's horrible. But I, you know, on race day, all bets are off. I want things to be most effective. So if you want to do it, you know, the mild way, you can lick your finger, stick it in the baggie, kind of like we used to do with those sugar fun dips back in the day before, you know, we knew what good nutrition was.
Oh, yeah, I remember those.
Oh, God, I love those. Every swim meet had one of those, man. No wonder I had such fast times. I was high on sugar. So you can stick your finger in and do it that way. But for the most part, it's carrying, you know, two things. super saturate your bottle. Whatever bottle, that first bottle that you're going to hold in your hand, put, you know, maybe 6 or 7 scoops of your hydration mix in there, and then take a sip from that, grab a water from an aid station. A sip from that, grab a water from an aid station. So as long as you don't take all that in at once, you'll be good to go. So that's trick number one. Trick number two is just carry some of the carrot. Heck, at this point, pour some into a water cup if you want. Slow down a little. That'll kind of give your, you know, your heart rate a chance to kind of go down, calm down. If you need to walk a little, plan it around an aid station so you can walk in there, pour, scoop a little of your hydration in, and take it in that way.
That's exactly what I've been doing. I've been tripling up my solutions. It's really thick. And so I use the water to help dissolve and take it in. And I'm doing good. But when I get to around mile 10, I'm pretty much done. I'm already looking for something else. And it, I get through the race, but I can tell that I'm a little bit dehydrated, even though I'm trying to, you know, I can only drink so much of the cups at every station, right? So, and I don't like hanging out there too long, but yeah, I stop for 10 seconds, do it, and I get going. But I'm now going to build up past my, you know, 13.1 every weekend deal. I'm going to start going a little further, and now I'm wondering how am I going to make it further, because I'm already stopping of my solution's already ended by mile 10, so I'm trying to figure out what's next. That was my question. What happens after that? So, go ahead.
So, I don't know what hydration product you're using, but there are some that are a little higher in sodium. So, Scratch Labs makes one that they have. It's, I think they call it their pre-race or whatever, but it has something like 1,000 milligrams of sodium in it.
Osmo has one too. I've used that before hot races that it kind of like preloads you. That makes a difference.
So you do then is utilize that as opposed to just a regular mix so that you get more of the sodium in, and then you just have to be really cognizant about how you're drinking. So if that bottle used to last you 10 miles, try to make it last 15 by taking, you know, because the hydration, the ratio of sodium and potassium and calcium and magnesium in there is at a higher concentration, so you need to make that last longer.
Okay, so let's just real quick, and now let you guys go on with other people. So let's talk about gels, about other fuel that's more of a food source. I love the idea you talked about the faster you go, digestion drops, so don't be eating so much because you're really not going to do much with it. So what do you keep going beyond the, if you will, the carbohydrate electrolyte base? What else can we fuel ourselves with the longer races, right?
So a lot of different possibilities. If you're an athlete that's looking for more carbohydrate fuel, you can do any of those little sporty beans, but their studies have found jelly beans have the exact same effect in terms of boosting your blood sugar. So,
that's awesome.
You know, Easter was just here. You can probably get a few discount jelly beans.
Have I been overpaying this whole time for like sports nutrition things?
For a lot of things probably.
Dang it, Elizabeth.
I know raisins actually. They did a study. Raisins actually have the exact same benefit. And you're actually getting a few more minerals than a traditional jelly bean. So one of those little box of raisins is you know an option there. You can pack your own. I will take one of those little mini Ziplocs if I'm going that carbohydrate route, and you can put in some of your own favorite dried fruits. You can just cut them up if you like mangoes or pineapples. You know, any of those, you can, I always, in mine, like I love coconut chips or banana chips if they're done in coconut oil. So those are good options to put in there. If you're more of a fat for fuel-based athlete, you know, the packets of nut butters, they sell packets of coconut oil. You know, heck, even honey, like those little honey sticks, I know we can get them at the farmer's market if that's an option for a fuel source. If you want to stay away from the traditional gels. I like some of the chews. I think Clif Bar, those chews, they make a good one. Pro Bar has some chews that are pretty good. I've heard that the new Bonk Breaker chews are tasty, but I haven't tried them yet. Heck, you can even make your own. there are a dozen recipes. Maybe I'll find one and give it to Nate to post up in the community for making your own gels. I've made mine with Ucan before, so that's always an option. So there's a few for you.
Wow. Okay, well, I'll get off, but thank you so much. I think I'm going to stay away from the gels I'm taking because I get gel overload after a while. I can't take anymore. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Sam, so much. So I'm going to put Sam back on all mute again. And, guys, we want to get some more questions. I know Jenny had a question in there and Dimitri had a question. But before we go into that, I actually wanted to publish this poll so you guys could see – you know, what's going on. And the math of this poll is interesting because I think 56 and 67% adds up to more than 100.
I'm no mathematician, but I think you're right.
I'm no mathematician, but I don't know about this. But anyway, we get a good sense. Maybe some of you guys double voted. I didn't even know that's possible, but maybe you're like, well, I struggle with both. So we'll interpret these results that way, you know, but it's interesting to see, you know, kind of what we struggle with. What do you make of these results, Elizabeth?
From what I see here, it's that really the stress around nutrition comes from fueling. And I think that's because a lot of people are worried or concerned that they're missing out on the secret to running faster or swimming or biking faster. So it's that part that they're the fear of missing out, like what's going on in the world. But then also I think a lot of runners get GI distress. And so it's this constant, like, what is wrong with me? What is going on when I'm racing, when I'm training, that what can I do better? So that's kind of what I see from there.
That's interesting. And, you know, I know that a lot of times you're getting questions from people and you in our group and obviously with your own athletes and you're troubleshooting. And sometimes it starts with the race day fueling, but pretty soon it transitions to like, well, how are you eating the rest of the day?
Yes. And this is my biggest, I will tell until I'm blue in the face, will tell people the absolute biggest performance improvement, life improvement, you know, beauty treatment, racing fuel, like everything, the most important thing you can do is to fix your daily diet. So the food that what you have at the end of your fork is the absolute best kind of medicine you can put into your body. And that starts with the meals, how you eat outside of training, because, you know, training is 1 hour to maybe, you know, 2 or 3 hours max. Whereas then you have that other 20 hours of the day that you're feeding your body. So those are the important decisions to be making. And then that fueling, that performance fueling is so, so secondary.
Yeah. You know, that's interesting you say it that way because, you know, in a very parallel sense, you know, that's how I think about, you know, running technique questions and shoe and gear questions related to, you know, how well you move throughout the day, how your posture is throughout the day, how your breathing is throughout the day. And for me, those things about strength and movement mobility, it's sort of synonymous with your nutrition. It's like if you can do that, you set yourself up just to be at a higher level. And then all of a sudden, when you go into the performance-related questions, they become a lot easier to solve. But most people start with the performance stuff first, and then the questions and the conversation very quickly shifts into this strength and movement. So I sort of see this parallel with this workout fueling and daily nutrition.
Absolutely.
I think
that's
kind of
why
cool.
You were kind of kind enough to let me start talking about and building this kind of, you know, nutrition piece that we've been working on is really trying to, like, we want to help our athletes. And so this is kind of the best way that we can do it is getting them to think about their, what's going on outside of their running, all, you know, how they're spending the majority of time in terms of movement and mobility and in terms of the food that they're putting in their mouth.
Totally. Should we show them what we've been working on?
Yeah.
All right, we got to
Please,
do it.
please. I'm so excited about it. They're going to love it.
All right, they're going to totally love this. So guys, Elizabeth has been, you know, with us for, you know, the last couple of months, you know, working on, you know, a few different things and getting to know you guys and getting a sense of, you know, what you need. And just as this poll was saying, it's like, you know, we need both. Like we're curious and probably most worried about, you know, the surface stuff, which in certain respects is how we're going to eat and when we eat a gel on the race. But, you know, the root of this really goes back to what you eat and when throughout the whole week. And, you know, Elizabeth, you've been running a business for a while, working with athletes of all levels, from running to triathlon and everything in between. And you've been creating meal plans for them.
I have. It's part of my goal to teach people how easy and fun and quick and tasty it can be to eat healthy and to fuel their body the right way as an athlete. Like I don't believe in diets. I don't believe in, you know, the quick fix or living your life to try to lose 5 pounds or 10 pounds. I believe as athletes, the power of food to fuel our body is the best choice that we can make in terms of getting better and being healthy. So it's seeing all the questions on the community is, you know, well, how do I eat? How do I do this? And I just thought, you know what, let's put something together that's super easy to follow, that's fun, that's tasty, and that has kind of my seal of approval in terms of balanced you know,
yes, the in-pin,
meals
the
that help with recovery,
approval.
That help, yes, that is the hashtag. So,
the in-pin approved.
INPYN approved, yep, which some people choose to use on things I question, but for the most part on great meals and, you know, great training, race, that kind of stuff. But yes, so we've put together this 14-day
program,
you know, dinner meals for athletes.
That's right. You know, and we wanted to start
eat
with
them
some.
For breakfast. That's great. But it's something I wanted.
Hello?
Sorry, go ahead.
Sorry, I thought I lost you there for a second. So we have this 14-day program that we're launching for you guys, and this is just the opening salvo. There'll definitely be more to come. But we wanted to create, you know, tapping into Elizabeth's knowledge and resource of working with athletes and doing this for a long time, creating something customized for you, for the Run Experience community. So we have this 14-day program called the Fast and Fit Food Plan. There's a lot in here. This is just the table of contents of this PDF that you would get, including, you know, 14 days of meals that would basically, you know, cover all your nutritional bases. I really like what, you know, Elizabeth has to say here about, you know, healthy, sustainable, nutrient-dense eating. Can you elaborate on that a little bit, just so people, you know, see what that is or know what that is?
Sure. So the idea, and it's something that I've seen time and again in with the athletes that I work with and even with myself, if you're not fueling your body properly, you're not going to get the results that you want. You're going to end up sick or injured or tired or just kind of always hitting this plateau. And it's very easy for athletes to want to pop a pill, take a supplement, follow the latest whatever diet trend that it is. But when it comes down to it, the absolute best way to eat is to eat the whole foods, you know, a whole food diet, real foods, the way that Mother Nature intended, because those foods have the vitamins and minerals and micro and macronutrients that we need to be resilient athletes, to recover, to sleep well, to be able to perform, to gain muscle, to get faster. All of those things are in the foods that we eat. And so when you're looking at your diet, people either do the same thing every day and they do, you know, oatmeal or an egg or got an egg white or something, some kind of thing for breakfast. And then dinners are like chicken, broccoli, brown rice, or nowadays chicken, quinoa, Brussels sprouts.
Something
that's like the new something like that. And they do eat that day in and day out. And while that's better than stopping at McDonald's on the way home from work, that's not going to get you the variety of vitamins and minerals, and certainly not the healthy fats that you need to be a strong runner.
You know, I'm really excited to follow this plan personally, because, you know, my wife and I, we definitely, I would put us in the generally good healthy eater categories. But, you know, it's funny, like we walk the same path through Trader Joe's every single week. You know, we pick up the same things, and, you know, every night we kind of make a similar dinner. So I'm actually really looking forward to, you know, adding some things to our repertoire where, you know, like the hardest thing is like I'm working, you know, 10 to 12 plus hour days, and I'm, you know, on line with you guys kind of putting all that energy out there. Sometimes the last thing I have at the end of the day is like any creativity for cooking myself.
Yep. And people, a lot of times you think it's going to be hard too, right? That like, oh, it must be complicated to come up with some kind of, you know, a recipe, and then by the time it takes to like cook it and put everything together, it's what I hear, kind of one of the highest compliments that I love from a lot of my clients is they're like, every week, I love it. You take all the stress off. My family, like, we don't have to worry about what we're eating all week long. Because, you know, I make a shopping list, I put things together, and it's all there, and I know that I'm going to try, in this case, you know, 5, 7, 10, 12 different meals. And once you've gone through them, then you're like, oh yeah, we like this one, this is good, we'll put this kind of into our regular routine.
That's
awesome. I had no idea that I, you know, loved kamut or amaranth, or wow, chicken thighs are actually better than I thought, and they're cheaper, so that's, you know. Those are all some of the benefits, I think, too.
I totally. And, you know, I love the little tips and putting this together with you, things that I learned, you know, like the idea of, you know, a lot of the recipes you do, which I think are cool, are single servings. So for those of you guys who are just cooking for yourselves, you have a recipe that you don't have to divide in half, because you're not cooking for six people all the time. Like, let's be honest, most of us are cooking for one or two people at night. But you show how you can easily double that recipe if you are cooking for your family or more people, or, and this is what I love, if you double the recipe, you've got leftovers and lunch for the next day. So I just figured, you're already cooking, it's not that much effort to do a little bit more, and then all of a sudden you're not eating that whatever, you know, questionable thing the next day. I love that.
That's one of my biggest time and money saving tips, is to just double up what you're making for dinner so that you have those leftovers the next day.
That's awesome. So
it's super easy and quick. I mean, really, like making one cup of quinoa or two, grilling two chicken breasts or four. It's you know, you're putting the work in, you might as well save some effort the next day and have it ready to go.
Totally. I love that. You know, and Sam is chiming in. He says, I'm a crock pot chef. Every weekend I make a pot, freeze a weekend for healthy meals, and makes me feel better about myself and my improvements show.
Sam is on point.
Sam is on point. He's been around for a little while. He's definitely taking in all this information and using it. So I just love this. And I'm just showing you guys what's in this, what you get. And then we're going to show you the page to show you how you can get it. And we're just launching this. We haven't launched this to anyone, right? So we're really excited to share this with you guys and give you a little sweet discount to start things off.
So Nate, my screen still has the quick poll, so I don't know if other people can
see. Oh, are you only seeing the poll? Okay, let me turn the poll off. Let's see here. The poll is closed. Let's hide results. Okay, you guys able to see this thing now?
There we go.
Oh, there we go. My goodness. Okay, so guys, da-da-da-da. This is why, you know, when we don't have Craig, I get in trouble. So we're back here. So you guys can see this fast and fit food plan right here. We've created this pretty awesome PDF, this little ebook that you're going to get. And in it, we have this table of contents. You're going to get a little bit about Elizabeth, an introduction to this philosophy and approach towards eating. We were just talking about some of the tips and the starting notes in there, like how to double up recipes, how to swap things out if you're allergic to something. One of my favorite things in here, actually, other than the weekly recipes, which we'll get to in a second, is the Daily Nutrition Survival Guide.
right? I kind of dubbed it the nutrition survival guide, which as I go through here is like, hey, how do you survive throughout the day? Because it's one thing to be able to cook in your own kitchen, but sometimes you guys are working late and you're pulled into the office. What are things that you could do ahead of time? So she's got these like five great points about how to start off with like a smoothie in the morning. And rest assured, there's going to be smoothie videos coming your guys' way. Everything from packing a lunch, little tips on hydrating, you know, really paying attention about snacking and emotional eating. Like there's just, you know, so much good stuff in here. And then, you know, we get into our different weeks. And each week, you know, you have this nutrient focus, Elizabeth. How'd you start doing that? And why is that important?
So I started doing this with all of my clients because I feel like we blindly kind of – like I don't want them just taking my advice or my meal plans and not learning from them. If I'm not teaching, then I'm not doing my job as a nutritionist. So part of giving them these healthy meal plans, I want them to learn what vitamins and minerals and nutrients are in the foods that they're eating, but also how those help them as an athlete. So specifically, I picked a couple for runners to go in this, like the vitamin K2 that a lot of people don't know anything about. Vitamin D gets a lot of attention, but we need vitamin K2 to help absorb that vitamin D. So it's really a teaching moment, and I think a value add that is something that I wanted, and then after you were familiar with it, that you wanted too for your runners and the running community to understand what these nutrients will do for them and where they can find them in their food.
And then beautiful segue, you were actually able to like highlight that those minerals in the actual
yes.
menu that you prepared, which is just like, that to
yep.
me is like, I don't know how you did that. It's amazing.
I'm magic. I've been doing it a while. So that's
so good.
Yes. Yes.
So we have this week.
And it's just easier.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just gonna say it's easier once people. I think it's how I get people away from, you know, looking at the calories in their food or looking at this and that to looking at, wow, I just ate a potassium and magnesium rich meal, or you know, I've got these are great foods for zinc. So when, you know, it's cold and flu season, I've got zinc in this and I've got vitamin C in this, and I don't need to go out and buy fake or dangerous supplements or spend a lot of money on things. I'm getting that in the foods that I'm eating.
That's really, really cool. I really like that approach. And, you know, this is specifically not a calorie counting approach to eating. Is that correct?
That's correct. We don't eat calories. We eat food.
I like that.
And yeah, so this is a healthy meal plan with food and nutrients that we need to fuel our bodies.
That's really cool.
But that being said, I know there are people that will ask. So you know, the meals are all under 650 calories. So which as athletes, you know. I don't know how many calories you're trying to consume during a day, but you definitely, you know, don't want to be under that 1,000 calorie mark. So 400 to 700 calories for a meal is a pretty good baseline.
That's cool. And I love the color of the food. They look really fun to make. They look tasty. And it's just nice to know that, like, man, I can just follow this. The recipes that you chose, they don't seem – you know, too complex. We're not asking anyone to be like a Michelin star chef in their French preparation,
nope.
You know, needs. It's just, you know, kind of chop and saute or whatever, which is so great. You know, do you want to talk about this recipe? You know, this like black bean quinoa tacos. I thought we could just preview
Absolutely.
One or two recipes just to give people a sense of what's going on.
Sure. So this is one of my personal favorites and one that a lot of my clients love because I try to encourage a meatless Monday, and that is
that's cool.
Has nothing to do with the fat. Like I'm not anti-meat, I am pro environment, and if we all adopt at least one day a week that we go meatless, it has a huge impact on our environment. So this black bean taco, it's full of protein, full of healthy fats. It's really easy and tasty, and it is approved by my meat-loving, non-bean-liking boyfriend.
Oh, that's good.
He's like, where, you know, he's like, if you give me this, I'm still gonna be hungry, and I'm not gonna, you know, where's my protein? And it, the beans and the quinoa together have such a powerful, you know, hearty taste to them, and there's flavor with kind of the barbecue sauce and some of the chili powder, you know, and cumin, that you're, you know, you don't quote unquote miss the meat.
That's really cool.
There's apple cider vinegar in there, which help with digestion. So, I mean, just a really, and I think something that's easy to make, and you can double and or triple this recipe and invite friends over, have a, you know, have a little taco fest. It's a family friendly one. Everyone can make their own tacos.
So, yeah.
There you go.
I love it. You know, I definitely like am a guy, and I've been hanging out in, you know, for better or worse, in the CrossFit community a little long with, you know, the influence of paleo eating and, you know, meat all the time. So I have a hard time going vegetarian mentally because I feel the same way. It's like, where is the sustenance in this meal? So, you know, describing what you just described kind of hits me right on the head. So I'll have to try this recipe out and see how it goes. And then this seemed really cool, the turkey stuffed cabbage rolls.
Yes, this is another kind of favorite of mine personally, because I like anything that you can make feel like a burrito.
I like that.
I don't know like where that comes from inside, but I love it. And it's kind of more finger food. And it's a really healthy way to do kind of quote unquote lower carbohydrate meal, which a lot of people are doing and interested in. You know, I will have some days that are lower carbohydrate than others, so this is a good one, and it's fun to do. It's fun to kind of wrap your food up in cabbage leaves. You know, the garlic, the onion, the cabbage, these all have you know, nutrient benefits that you're getting out. And then in the recipe, I have a cup of cooked rice, easily replaceable with quinoa, amaranth, any one of those, like ancient grains. It's fun. If you don't want ground turkey, you could do, you know, it's easy to sub in beef or bison or ground chicken. If you're plant-based, it's easy to sub in, you know, mushrooms, lentils. If you go the textured vegetable protein route, the TVP route, that is kind of the closest. It kind of tastes like a meat crumble. So it's just an easy one. To then take and adapt all of these recipes after you've tried them. You can, you know, if you want to throw in any vegetable or grain that you have on hand, it's easy to make that switch.
Yeah, I really like that. I like that flexibility, these good baselines. So anyway, guys, you've got this great 14-day program, which, you know, to me is really like what you guys are doing and why you're here with the Run Experience. It's like, hey, let's be athletes again before we're just runners. Let's get into that strength. Let's learn more about mobility and about taking care of ourselves, and we can do those things. Our running is going to improve. Our performance is going to improve. And this, for me, has been the missing link, has been the nutrition side. So I've been really excited to bring Elizabeth on here and share and showcase some of her knowledge. Now, in addition to this plan and program, just like you get with our programs, is you get coaching support and community support. So you'll have access to Elizabeth in the Facebook group. She'll be hanging out. You tag her. She'll be able to answer your questions and help you out. And I want to take, I think we got time for one more live question. I'm hoping I can get Jenny on. But I just want to show you guys where you can get this program. I'll be sending out a link in an email afterwards, so don't worry. But I'm going to drop this link to the program in little questions tab. So the questions and comments, I'm going to send this to everyone, so you guys should be able to see that. And we have this little payment page right here. The program, normally $50, but if you do it today, we have our little coupon code EATBETTER. And if I apply that coupon, Shazam, I'm going to get 20% off this thing. So I'll get this thing for $40. We're launching this out. You guys are the first ones to get this. We're really excited to share this. And we have a little upgrade for those of you guys who aren't in the 30-day challenge yet and you want to work on your running strength and mobility and your nutrition. You have a chance to actually get $50 off the 30-day challenge as well. So a pretty sweet deal. Either way, guys, there's some killer testimonials on this page. You should definitely just check this out and see what some of Elizabeth's athletes have to say about working with her and the power of eating so well and so cleanly. So that's in the link right there. For those of you guys who are listening to the recording, I'm going to be sending out a link, you know, in the show notes below and in an email afterwards. So we're really, really pumped. Let's see if Jenny is still around. Jenny, I'm going to unmute you because you had some great questions about, you know, training for a marathon and trying to lose weight. Jenny, I see a green mic. Do you want to chime in and see if we can get you?
Sure. Can you hear me?
We got you.
All right, wonderful. No, I was thinking a lot about this upcoming call all week and about nutrition and my upcoming marathon. I've never done one before. I've done halves, and they've been pretty awful. But I used to love running. 2013, I was out running all the time, absolutely loved it. And then I had a baby last year, and I haven't gotten rid of all the baby weight yet, so I'm about 30 pounds heavier than when I used to really love running and was doing it all the time. And everything I found online today when I was reading about trying to lose weight while training for a marathon basically just said, don't even try it. So I'm kind of stuck. Like, I don't really know what to do because I know all this weight is dragging me down and making it really hard for me to really enjoy running and to get into this training that I'm trying to do.
Of course. Elizabeth, what would you have to say there?
I say, first of all, congratulations on being a mom. That's incredible.
Thanks.
That's, you know, I commit, like, you've been through something that is way more challenging than a marathon. So pat yourself on the back and know, like, train with confidence and know that you will get through this no matter what.
Oh, man.
In terms of the weight loss, and, you know, I think a lot of people, when they're coming, at least to me specifically, they're looking at, you know, oh, I want to drop 5 pounds or 10 pounds or, oh, I, you know, or a lot of times they just, you know, are associating being leaner with going faster. And the recommendation there comes in terms of it's more for performance-based. It's like something give if you're all of a sudden drastically cutting calories and drastically reducing the amount of available food and energy. In your case specifically, and with other, you know, some other athletes, I think it is possible, and it's one step at a time. So it's first of all looking at your daily diet. What kinds of foods are you eating and consuming? Are you eating a whole food diet? Are you are you eating at late at night before going to bed? You know, are there times, like, we all have these things, right? We all have kind of this either a snacking habit or a coffee in the morning habit, like one of those flavored-y whatever coffees that's really like a milkshake. Are you, you know, so there,
hey,
there's
hey, don't a, knock the frappuccino.
Yeah, and I don't even know what they're called. That's why I'm not a coffee drinker, but I see them, you know, with mounds of whipped cream and like chocolate sprinkles and caramel sauce, which is fine, you know, then you have to account for that somewhere else. So I think that's the easiest way to start. And then in terms of looking to lose weight, like, find a meal plan, and whether it's through, you know, obviously I think that the meal plans that we have here would be great for you to start with. I think it would give you an idea of portion sizes of some foods that are really good for you. But then finding a system that works for you in terms of food, like batch cooking things, and then setting yourself kind of a structured schedule. So I do think it's possible. I don't want you to believe that you can't do both at the same time. But I think you want to be cognizant on, you know, like on your long run days. So if, you know, as you're boosting up your training for your marathon, don't starve yourself on your long run days. Don't use that as a diet. Like, refuel properly, fuel beforehand properly. The other 6 days of the week, be smart about your eating. So that's a tip. And then, you know, reducing the amount of kind of processed foods that you're eating will make a really big difference. So again, I'm not saying I don't believe at all you're sitting there eating like potato chips and cereal, but you know, if you have bread on your sandwich, like look for maybe, you know, there's some really good paleo wraps that Julian's Bakery makes. I love them. I think, you know, they're made with like coconut and something else. So look for alternatives to that sandwich bread. Find alternatives, healthier alternatives to the foods that you're eating. I think that's a great place to start.
All right. Thank you so much. I really appreciate
it. You're welcome. Good luck. In your training.
For sure.
I appreciate it.
And you know, the other thing I'm going to add, Jenny, and this is something that I strongly believe in my own philosophy, is that our bodies are a reflection of our lifestyle and the lifestyle we live. And that involves not only, you know, our weekend activities and hobbies like marathon running and training, but, you know, everything we do throughout the day, how much we move, the quality of our movement, and the types of other fitness things that we do. So I always get this question about, you know, why, you know, with strength training, for example, sometimes people are afraid about bulking up or doing this or doing that. And really what I found is that, just like Elizabeth was saying, is like if we kind of focus on sound training principles, you know, keeping the body as healthy as possible, giving it all that good stuff, you know, training smart, training consistently, adding intensity in there, adding regular strength training, you may find you will actually, you know, like the percentages in terms of your body composition may change a little bit. You may not necessarily lose weight, but you'll still feel like you'll have more energy and you'll look better and you'll be healthier. You're like your body will shake out where it wants to be, and it'll be in a healthy place. Sometimes when we hear about, well, you know, I want to lose X weight, you know, like, says who? Who says that that previous weight was your happy, healthy, best weight? You know, it's kind of this arbitrary number. But I find if we really focus on the process, our body is going to go where we want it to go.
Sounds great.
Great advice.
Well, Jenny, thank you so much. Good luck in your training and give a holler.
Keep us posted on how it's going.
Thank you.
Everyone loves a baby picture. Post that in the group on your next run so we can all, you know, cheer you on.
Thank you.
When he needs running lessons, I'll give you my pager number.
There you go.
Okay. Thanks, Jenny.
Thank you.
Of course. So, man, Elizabeth, we got through a lot, huh?
Oh, we did. Can I give like a quick recap of a couple main points for everybody?
Let's do it. Let's do the recap.
I know you love the recap. So first of all, the 14-day meal plan, you guys have to try it out. A lot of good food in there. And I'm not just saying that because I wrote it.
That's right.
I'm saying it because I've had the food and it's tasty. So try it out. Let me know how much fun you're having in the kitchen again. And then as far as our marathon, kind of the tips that we talked about tonight for those that are, if you're racing Boston, best of luck. I can't wait to hear how it goes. Nate, I know you're going to do really well. And we're all going to be kind of following along and anxious to hear how it goes. But for upcoming marathons as well, the pre-race dinner, it's where it's at. Pay attention to that the night before. I liked that next morning, I call it like breakfast and clearance time. Leave yourself a window so your body can kind of absorb and digest. As pacing and your speed increases, decrease digestion rate. So be cognizant of that with how much you're eating. Hydration before the point of dehydration. That's the key. So sticking with your hydration. I know Sam's on top of it. I hope everybody else is too. And then follow a plan. And if you don't have one, make one. Now's not too late. Sit down, look at how you've been training. And then when you get out there, follow that plan. Don't veer off course. There you go.
I like that.
You'll be set.
That is so good. Well, Elizabeth, once again, thank you so much for being on here. Guys, thank you for listening and attending. We really hope you check out our Fast and Fit food plan. We got you guys a little sneak peek behind the scenes of what's going on, as well as some of the tastier recipes you can see in there. We're selling this thing for $50, but
if you use our little Eat Better coupon, you get $10 off. So 40 bucks, you get 2 weeks of meal plans, access to some probably the best nutrition coaching out there. I'm definitely biased. I think it is. And I've been around a while and I've seen the different stuff that's out there. Guys, we're so excited to launch this. We really hope you check this out. And we really can't wait to start working with you on your nutrition and your fueling. And we're really going to complete the circle with everything else. And oh man, you guys are just going to crush once you have all these boxes checked.
Exactly.
Well, excellent.
Taking the world by storm. It's been fun. Great night of calls and questions. And, you know, I try to get into the group as much as I can when you guys tag me on stuff. I know there are a couple like carbohydrate questions that were on here that I would love to take the time to get to and help everybody out. So keep those coming as the week goes on and as we grow as a group. These are awesome. Let's do more of these, Nate. These are fun.
We're going to do more. Well, excellent, guys. Well, thanks so much. And Elizabeth, thank you. And guys, have a good night. Thanks for listening in.